Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore. And because I live, you shall live also. Dear friends, we've gathered here this afternoon to praise God and to give thanks for the life of John Toth. We come together in our grief, acknowledging our human loss, asking that God might grant us grace, that in pain we might find comfort, in sorrow, hope, and in death, resurrection. Let me begin with a passage of scripture from Psalm 139. You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know where I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me, and your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me, and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like day, for darkness is light to you. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days adorned for me, for you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Were I to count those days, they would outnumber the grains of the sand. When I awake, I am still with you. If only you, God, would remind us of your everlasting love. Normally, in a service like this, I reserve my comments to be made later. I like to see what the others might say, and then I try to tie things up. But I felt very strongly that I needed to speak first today. See, I knew Nick for probably 35 years. Excuse me, John, for about 35 years. And you know, he was, along with his staff, just one of the great photographers. And as I thought about photography, I thought about this scripture and what the scripture said. It talked about knowing us and going to where we go and being a part of our life and knowing our days. And certainly John was a very big part of my life. Think of it for a moment, what a photographer does. First of all, the photographer gains an insight into the whole environment. When I take a picture, I might point my camera at someone's face, but I'm not necessarily looking at the background. I'm not necessarily looking at the surroundings, but a photographer knows the full picture. And a photographer then focuses the lens upon its subject and then captures that subject. And for me, if I'm taking a picture, that's about it. I take it on my phone, it's there, might be there forever. But a photographer then will go and take that picture and spend some time looking at the blemishes. Maybe there's a hair out of place. Maybe there's a scar over the eye. Maybe there's a blemish on the chin. Maybe there's something that's not quite right, and a photographer will go and make it right and then preserve that image for all time. I've got about 35 years of Christmas cards that the dark room has produced for my family over the years. And it started when there were four stockings hanging on our mantle. And each year we would go to the dark room and we would take a picture, and in their great craftsmanship, they would create a card for us that followed the development of our family. In time, there were five stockings, and then there was a dog, and then there was a cat, and then there was a year when the dog was not there, but the cat was still there, and then there was a year when there was another dog, and the cat was then gone, and we had all of these Christmas experiences captured in front of our fireplace, where the stockings grew from four to five, and then eight, and now 15 stockings that hang upon our mantle. And John and the darkroom staff have been a part of all of those. They know the Culpepper family because they have been intimately involved in capturing our story and helping us to celebrate life and to share the joys of life with family and friends. You know, when you think about it, isn't that what God does? Doesn't God know the whole picture? Sometimes when we don't know the whole picture, but sometimes we're just in our own little world, we're not quite sure what's happening around us, but God knows the whole picture. And then God focuses God's attention upon each one of us individually, and he knows us by name, knows us by height, knows us by gender, knows us by age, knows who we are. And so God focuses his attention upon us, and then he captures us. Just like a photographer captures that picture, God captures us and holds us for all time. And God removes the blemishes. He holds nothing against us. He takes away the things that would mar our lives and removes them from us and reveals us for just who we are in God's eyes. And then God follows us throughout all the generations. You know, John was full of a lot of joy. Anytime I saw him, he would tell me a story. I wouldn't understand half of them, but but I'd laugh with him, because it was something that did bring to me great joy and brought to him great joy, and just to have that experience and to know that John had been a part of my life just like he was a part of every one of your lives here today. So in fact, in reality, as he viewed the world around each one of us and focused his attention on us and captured us and removed our blemishes and shared us with the world. John, perhaps unknowingly, was doing the Lord's work, bringing to this world great joy and helping us to remember the wonderful blessings that have been shared with us throughout the years. And that's what we've come to do today, is to remember the wonderful blessings that John has brought to us in his life and in his work. And I'm going to ask Caroline if she would come, and anybody that would like to stand with her. And Caroline's going to begin us with a word of prayer.
Okay. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for bringing us here today to remember my papa. We thank you for letting this amazing man be a part of our lives and for the amazing memories we have with him. And Lord, we pray during this hard time you show us peace and remind us that you are always with us. Lord, we thank you and we love you. Amen.
Memorial service where we get to hear Ricky, don't lose that number, and some Lynyrd Skynyrd thrown in the midst, but it's music to the spheres, and certainly appropriate for John. We all have stories, I'm sure, but we want to focus a little bit on some of those who perhaps knew John best. So we've got Kevin Crotty, and we've got Hal Hart, and we've got the Toth boys that are going to come and share that which God has placed upon their heart. I'm going to ask Kevin if he'd come first.
This is different type of memorial, and it should be. He was a different kind of guy. Nick, B.
Thank you all.
Y'all know how much I appreciate this. It means a lot to me that you asked me to do this. I'd walk into the house at 205 Palmetto. I'd hang a hard left, go in the master bedroom, walk past the foot of the bed, over to the dresser, and I'd grab the forest green bottle with the gold cap on it. This is Polo Cologne. I'd snag me a few squirts. Then I'd head into the kitchen. You know, Miss T always told me, you always smell really good. Had she known the whole story, it made a lot of sense to her. He was my Mr. T, and I was his Kevy. Hey, Kevy, sup, dude? That's how he greeted me. You know, he wasn't just my best friend's dad. He was my guy. We laughed together. There were moments where we cried together. At times, he referred to me as his other son. And that was an honor. I loved Mr. T, and he loved me. You know, the Dos Equis, they thought they had found the most interesting man in the world, but obviously, they didn't know Mr. T. He knew cars. He knew boats. He knew motorcycles. He could fish. He could cook. He could party. He was handy, innovative, creative. He could tell a story, and he could tell a joke. And he could tell a tall tale or two. He knew about appliances, lighting, but when it came to audio and visual, he was a master of the craft. Hey, Kevy, listen to this. I jump into the passenger seat of the 6 Series BMW. You know, he had the sweetest custom rims, the BBS rims. He had like a 10-inch JL audio woofer in his trunk, which only the high school kids really had. He had the mid-range speakers, the highs, the equalizers, and you probably don't know what I'm talking about. I didn't either, but I know for the next 20 minutes, it was 1969, we were at Woodstock, and we were listening to Santana play Soul Sacrifice, and it sounded pretty good. As you had mentioned, he had an enthusiasm and excitement about life that was contagious. Whatever he was into, you were too. He was awesome. And back inside 205 Palmetto, you hang a right this time, you go into the entertainment room. It was once a two-car garage, or a garage. But now it housed the big screen TV, the latest laser disc technology, surround sound. I'm talking about some serious surround sound. And I'm sure we listened to, or we experienced, we watched, we listened to, you know, Star Wars, Raiders of the Lost Ark, all those movies that had the soundtracks that were composed by John Williams, you know, just masterpieces. But I got a vivid memory, and Nick and I talk about this a lot. It was Karate Kid. It was the final scene. Daniel LaRusso, he's going to fight. He's there. He's on the mat, and he strikes the crane pose, and the music crescendos, and the room just comes alive, and you feel like you're there. Well, LaRusso, he strikes the victorious blow, and you see Mr. Miyagi over on the sidelines, and he's beaming with pride. And I look over my shoulder, and I see our Americanized Mr. Miyagi standing next to the surround sound with his fingers on the controls, and he, too, is beaming with pride, knowing that he just delivered this big cinema, so dynamic surround sound experience for us all. It never got old to him. Quite honestly, as long as he was excited about it, we were too. Mr. T, he was adventurous. He lived life. It was always interesting to know, what's Mr. T doing? Cruises, concerts. Maybe he's going to watch the Detroit Red Wings in the NHL playoffs. Maybe he's going to run his boat down to the Bahamas. He could be meeting Buffett for a margarita. I wouldn't put it past him. I mean, after all, he was boys with Bob Seger in the Silver Bullet Band. One of his best buddies, Perry, who unfortunately couldn't be here, he was the drummer for the Silver Bullet Band. They used to actually practice old-time rock and roll in their basement. Mr. T was chill. He was forgiving and served me well at times. Nick had a party at Palm Street, and my buddy and I, not Nick, we discovered this really cool bottle. It was a single bottle, but it was two chambers. On one side, it was a coffee liqueur. On the other side, it was like a Irish cream. I know, something kind of weird to get excited about, but my partner in crime that night, I mean, he hadn't graduated to drinking beer yet. He was still sipping on Zimas. So the coffee liqueur was right up his alley. Well, the next morning, the bottle was empty, and it didn't look so cool. And Nick came and berated us and told us that his dad had brought it back from Ireland or Europe. And the last thing I wanted to do was disappoint or disrespect Mr. Toth. So every year, for the next 25 years, I took him a bottle of vodka, a nice one. It turns out, though, that this act of my annual restitution, I guess it was ultimately self-gratifying. For many of these years, Brittany and I would deliver the bottle to him on Christmas Eve, which would turn into us hanging out in the garage, playing ping pong, me beating Nick, slapping B around, you know. Just a good night of simple fun. And by the way, the coffee liqueur was not from Europe or Ireland. You could get it at any local liquor store for about $25. So Mr. T was always there. He was at school pictures. He was at sports pictures. He was at dance, taking dance pictures, even my wedding pictures, which was one of the last ones he shot in film. He wasn't just my photographer, though. He was a big fan of mine. He was a big fan when I played soccer at Glen. And every time you would see him, there was that bald, sun-kissed head, that tightly groomed white goatee. Hey, Kevy, sup, dude? I loved running into him in those perfectly timed, random moments. And I'm going to miss those moments. Dickie Betts of the Allman Brothers, he sang a song, Blue Sky. You're my blue sky, you're my sunny days. Mr. T was just that. Nick, B, friends, family, thank you for letting me share these. For sharing these moments with you. And this time, at this time, I ask that everyone pay close attention to what I have to say. In about 15 seconds, I'm going to provide y'all with some simple instructions, and I request that you respond accordingly. You may have to do it twice because it's a big crowd. But in honor of Mr. T, and as an ode to my guy, everybody say pickles!
Pickles!
Everybody say pickles!
Pickles!
Got it.
My name is Hal Hart. I'm going to tell you a story. When I found out John was sick, I said, what can I do? What can I do? And I got thinking one day at work of all the wonderful times that we had had together and things that we shared. And I'm not a writer, but I started writing. And every day I would try to write a chapter of how I felt about John and the experiences that we had. So this is the beginning of memoirs, and again, I'm not a writer. My wife accuses me of brambling. I don't bramble, but I will read to make it short. So I'm the one that brought the toast to Georgia. First paragraph was, when I met John Toth the first time. If you can't hear me, let me know. I met John at the Detroit airport in the mid-70s. He was there.
Pardon?
Right into the mic.
I can't hear you back here.
Just get
step close, okay. When I met John Toth the first time, I met John at the Detroit airport in the mid-70s. He was there to pick me up and then train me on the new photo printing machines that my boss, Larry Case, had bought Case Photoshop on St. Simon's Island. I did not realize that I had a one-way ticket, and that would be driving back with this bearded, wild-haired, crazy man. The trip to John's place of work was quick and scary. We loaded up the machines, and off we went to John's house. In a Kodak yellow, he says it was a Ford, so I'll say Ford, very large Keep On Trucking logo across the back, and two very large cartoon characters with even larger floppy feet tripping up on each side of this van. I saw the van, I thought, this guy's a hippie. Upon entering John's neighborhood, John reached over and locked his door and suggested that I do the same. I was stunned. Thinking to myself, I had heard that Detroit was tough, but I had no idea you had to lock your doors to go home. When you got to John's house, I met John's wife, Sue, and John's bearded, even wilder-haired roommate, Ron. John loaded his and Sue's stuff, and it was time to go. John was driving. I was in the seat besides John, and Sue was in the back. If you have not driven with John in the early days, you would have no idea of what you would be in for. I was from the South, and we never ridden with a young city driver like John. It was wild and crazy. It was like we were in a race. I couldn't close my eyes for hours. I kept hoping John would tire and I could drive. Sue would offer to drive, but John wasn't letting anyone drive until we got to the mountains of Tennessee. John relented and let me drive. John crawled on to the two photo machines we had in the back. These photo machines were about 6 feet long. They had a table in front of them and had masses of knobs on them. Okay, so it was mountains of Tennessee. It was early dawn. The sun was just coming up, and John crawled up on the two facing work shelves of these photo machines. These machines must have had 20 or so different colored knobs of different sizes, and on the shelf, John laid with a blanket covering him. Sue and I were talking about what St. Simon's was like and when we had to slow to a crawl on the interstate. When we got to the top of the mountain, as we looked down, there were police cars on both sides of the interstates, lights flashing, and officers walking down long sides of the stopped cars. We guessed that they were looking for an escaped convict as they were opening car doors and looking inside. We wondered how long this process was going to take. When a police officer opens our door, looked inside, saw John on a table with all the knobs, and got all excited and yelled something to the effect, "Don't worry, I will get you through this." Swear to God, it's the truth. He got on his radio and told everybody to let us pass. Cars pulled aside, and Sue, John, and I drove right through the roadblock. We were dumbfounded. As we drove along at higher speed, we could only guess that when the officers looked in and saw John, he must have thought John was on life support and was not going to hold us up. John slept through the whole thing. So I bring John and Sue to Golden Isles. We finally get to St. Simon's Island, and I'm telling John and Sue what this is and what that is. We go to Case's Photoshop and unload the machines, and I take John and Sue over to 1108 Ocean Boulevard, the Urgle's Nest, our rented house. It was late afternoon. I introduced Dawn to John and Sue. We cleaned up, and we go to the Crab Trap for dinner. After dinner, we ride around the village and other sites of the island, and around 9 p.m., we go back to our house. We invite John and Sue to spend the night, as we had two extra bedrooms. John said they had to get back. I told John he was crazy. They could sleep 10 hours or so and get an early start. John insisted that they had to get back. We exchanged contact information. And John said, get this, "We will be back," and left for Detroit. It wasn't until later that we found out that when on I-16 at Macon, they took a left, easy to do, and ended up at the Georgia-Florida line. That's where they decided to get some sleep and start over.
Thanks, y'all. That was awesome. Thanks for everybody being here. This could be better. It's a gorgeous day. Just sunny enough for the top of his head to keep on getting sunburned. He had every car he had had a sunroof, and I never understood it. It's like, why does my head hurt so bad? Thank you so much to the Williams family. My dad absolutely adored every one of y'all. And it means the world for you guys to open this place up to us. My dad definitely thought and probably preferred Kevin as a son, what Kevin just said, but there was plenty of times when we were, Josh and I would be off somewhere hunting, and he'd ask me, "Did you kill anything or catch a big fish?" He's like, "No, Josh did." He's like, "Man, I wish he was my son." And I would say, "Well, I wish Charlie was my dad." But seriously, y'all, it means the absolute world to us. I didn't write anything down, which I've had to do this before at a funeral, and I just caught myself like reading and babbling and getting through it as fast as possible, like you would in like 11th grade English or something like that. So, but just to tell a quick story and about this old guy. So, kind of going off of, and I'm stealing a page from Hal's stories continued that he wrote, which is really great. We're working to get it into publishing anytime soon, so look out for it in 2032. 32 or 36. So anyways, So my dad, when he came down here, he was working for Larry Case. Probably not going to get into all the legality stuff. Long story short, dad had the note on some equipment that he bought when he decided to move down here, and they were in our Longview spot that you guys know, Old St. Simon's folks, where we were at Longview. So dad was there before he was actually in Redfern at the dark room, and it was Casey Color Lab then. Well, one thing that kind of led to the other through the years, or not, I don't even know if it was years, it was probably faster than that, where dad was getting a bad vibe from him. And one day became, and I don't know who had the lease or who had what, but dad, that photo equipment was his inside there. Larry had, did I name names? He had, he changed the locks on dad. And my dad was a young 20-something from Detroit. And he's like, this doesn't work that way. And so, so I heard this story a million times over the years. And even when we would go to Bubba's after Carlton opened Bubba's in the back of the all dark room, which we'd since moved to Frederica North, you could see where the bricks were still cut out from when dad broke in there. And I heard this story a million times from so many different perspectives. But this is, it's kind of like the beginning of a joke. It's like, I heard it from a friend, I heard it from a lawyer, and I heard it from a sheriff. So dad decides on a Sunday that he's going to call up Hal. And, or I think it may have been Saturday night, because I think it went down on a Sunday. He says, Hal, he's like, you locked me out, you know, this and that, that stuff's mine, I've got the note on it. Got a really good idea. We're just going to bust out the cinder blocks, or we're going to drag it off in a trailer, and everything will be fine. We're not going to get in trouble. And Hal said, can I talk to Don, and maybe we'll talk later? And Hal never talked to him again, and then he heard that my dad was arrested the next day. So back up again, he called his other friend, who's a lawyer, asking for legal advice, which John Farrell extremely, you know, over and over again said was a really, really bad idea. Which my dad, I guess, accepted the fact that he knew what he was talking about, but really didn't care. Not positive who helped him, but he went and did it. And so this is about probably 15 years ago. I was at a Georgia game, and I think I was talking to Andy, maybe Carl Alexander, and we're talking to a group of people, and he goes, do you know Sheriff Wayne Bennett? And I was like, yeah, Nick Toth. And he goes, Nick Toth? John Toth's son? And I was like, yo, boy. Yeah, yeah. He's like, have you ever heard about the largest heist in Glenn County back in the early 80s? And he's like, no. Which I had, obviously. He's like, yeah, it was on the cover of the Brunswick News. John Toth steals $70,000 with phone cover. But my dad, being the very arrogant person, was in the back of the car as Wayne was taking him to jail and talked in his own way, got him on his side. He's like, look, this is my stuff. And explained the whole story to him. And Wayne took a liking to my dad real quick while we were on the way to jail. And he's like, all you got to do is find Don Blaylock. because he signed a note for me with Barnett Bank. And so Wayne, I guess, went above and beyond because he thought the story was hilarious and tracked him on the golf course and had him sign an affidavit that it was my dad's equipment he got out. So he's got some legendary stuff like that. My dad was my boss. My dad was my dad. But most importantly, like more than all those things, like my dad is my best friend. I spend every minute with him, you know, and we'd go to work and we'd argue a lot. We'd disagree a lot, because believe it or not, he was opinionated, and so am I, so am I. But we had a way of turning it off. You know, when we walked out of there, we were father and son again and best friend, but we were always best friend. And, you know, it's very, who cares about the right word to put this into perspective, but it's just odd. You know, it's, I know everybody here in this place right now lost a loved one and taken a torn into the chin, have lost a loved one. And you feel like you can call them. You feel like they're right there. You turn a corner and you hear their voice. You see them on the side. You see them riding down the highway. A friend of mine, I'm not going to name names, said that to me. Have you seen your dad on the highway yet? I see him everywhere. I see him in every corner. I hear his voice in every place. And thank you guys so much for being here and celebrating our good buddy. I know he touched the lives of everybody in this place. And we're so happy that we're able to do this with you guys.
Thank you. Beautiful. You guys hear me? So my dad would tell Nick that he wished Kevin was his son, and my friends would tell me that they wished my dad was their friend. It kind of made me jealous. He was that cool, and he really was everybody's friend. I just want to say maybe six things that'll always stick with me, and things like this. Like, I was with him in Atlanta. He was having back surgery. He ended up doing really well from that. He was so dedicated to getting better. And it was just me and him, and that ended up being rare when it was just me and him, which, important. And the nurse came in, and she was going to hook him up to the IV, and she said, "All right, sweetie, can I have your arm?" And he looked right at her, and he said, "No, I need it for work." And I mean, how did he do that? And he probably did that 100 times a day. He taught me the power of music by just one sweet anecdote. It was just me and him and my grandmother Esther in Detroit. And he looked right at me and he said, "Do you want to know why the Beatles are important?" And I said, "Yes, Dad, I do." And he said, "Okay, I'll show you." And he put on the White Album and he played Helter Skelter. And my grandmother said, "Turn it off." "No, Johnny, turn it off. This is that's I don't like that song." Did he turn it off? And then he put on I Will, which is the same album. And she said, "Oh, that Johnny, that's sweet." And he looked at me and he said, That's why they're important. Because they could do that in the same breath. Which I thought was really beautiful. And I love music ever since he said that. I'm surprised there wasn't more jokes about him being late. Seriously. Because he was. So what I like to say is that it was well known that my dad was constantly late. It was also well known that he liked to drive fast. But I don't think he ever drove fast because he was late. I wrote my English paper when I was in college about Frank Zappa because he stuffed so much knowledge in my head about him, and I do love him. He taught me and Nick every word to Johnny Be Good in the back of Buster Crabs. I don't know how late it was, but it was late. But no matter what, I mean, the sun could have rose and he still would have made us learn every word. Yeah, and I never even realized that the song is actually called Johnny Be Good. He never rushed anybody in a conversation. He did talk a lot, but he contributed and he took all those conversations very seriously. And, to be that purposeful with everything that you do and not care what was happening next, and to be in the moment like that and to take it that seriously, I think is pretty special. And I think really indicative of this place and, the love that he brought to it all over the world, in his lives, no matter where he lived. And yeah, he loved people. And I in terms of photography, his best pictures were of people, that's for sure. Even though he was great. He could take anything, but he sure did have a knack of making people smile and making that picture genuine. And he used to skid out on that 635, that gold one, three times before he made it to
Frederick Road.
And he did it, and when he did it the second time, we knew that was going to happen. When he did it the third time, it was a tradition that we needed him to do. He was cool. He always tried to give me his old clothes because he knew how good I thought he looked, but they never fit me, obviously. Because he's got his sleeves tailored. at that man. He was so proud of being Hungarian. You know, our last name is Toth. That's a very, very strong. Toth is like a Slavic nation. It's Slovenian. I don't know if you guys knew that. But he did a genealogy test, and he called me right up, and he said, "Turns out, we're Scottish." You know, I said he never ever, he did not drive fast when he was late. He was calm, he was cool. But he was late to a Carlos Santana concert one time when we were going, and man, he really, really went after it that time. He was panicked. We love that y'all are here. He's the best. He's the best to me and Nick. And we were so lucky. And hopefully some of those stories will stick with y'all, and that you know what we're talking about. I always knew what he was talking about. So I love y'all. Really glad y'all are here. Okay.
One last thing, guys. So growing up, my dad, which was mentioned about love of cooking, and B and I definitely celebrated this yesterday with chopping so much more onions than we needed for the gumbo just to chop and cut stuff up all over our kitchen yesterday. Dad loved cooking, and we used to cook as young as we could remember. It was one of us would chop and one of us would clean. And he always said, and he let us kind of curse and say this word, which I'm going to say, I hope that's okay. It's not a bad one. All right, boys, at my funeral, when I die, what are you going to say? And we would say every time, Danny was a good cook.
Thanks, B. I want to take one exception to something you said, and that was you may have occasionally found him to rush a conversation with you when he was on the phone with you. And I will also say, I never noticed him speeding through our neighborhood. We live on the same street. And the reason being is, right by my house, there's a spot where everybody's cell phone drops. And if he was talking to you, he would be driving slow, trying to finish that conversation before he hit that spot. Or he would say to you something like, we've got to get off the phone because Reverend Culpepper doesn't allow cell phones in his church. So I didn't know that until a little while ago, but I appreciate the fact that he drove slow in our neighborhood and took the time to savor his call for you. You know, you could have gone into his studio and there would have been a perfect screen behind you and you would have been sitting at the right height and the lighting would have been just right to capture your portrait. But the chances are you knew him from chasing you down at the ball field, or out in the marsh, or out on the ocean, or in one of the creeks, or underneath the Avenue of Oaks, or in your backyard, or wherever you were that was important to you. Because that's what he did. He came to what was important to you. Just like God does. You can go into his house and everything be perfect there, but just know this, that God, through people like John and through people like you, go everywhere and bring the grace, the goodness, and the mercy and the light of God's love, even to fiddlers. God is here, John is here, we are here. And we're richly blessed. I'm going to offer a word of prayer, and then Chris is going to bless us with another song. And when that song is over, you're welcome to move upstairs. Let us pray. God of us all, your love never ends. When all else fails, you're still God. We pray to you for one another in our need, and for all anywhere who mourn with us this day. To those who doubt, give light. To those who are weak, strength. To all who have sinned, mercy. To all who sorrow, your peace. Keep true in us the love with which we hold one another. In all our ways we trust you. And to you, with your church on earth and in heaven, we offer honor and glory now and forever. O God, all that you have given us is yours. At first you gave John to us. Now we give John back to you. Receive John into the arms of your mercy. Raise John up with all your people, and receive us also, and raise us into a new life, and help us to so to love and serve you in this world, that we may enter into your joy in the world to come. Amen.
Thank you. camera is at.